Our second reading comes from Paul's letter to the Galatians, the fifth chapter, beginning with the first verse and then skipping down
to the 13th verse. Listen for the word of God. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence. Love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love the Lord, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. These are opposed to each other and prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now, the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, things like these. I am warning you as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. We live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
One of my favorite bike rides is the New River Trail State Park in Virginia. It's only a couple of hours from Salisbury. It follows an old railroad bed as it winds from Galax to Pulaski. In an effort to keep the tracks smooth and steady, they followed the river and added tunnels and bridges whenever necessary. It makes a fun ride. Many of the bridges are small, crossing creeks where they enter the New River. But there are two that are quite striking: the Hiawassee Bridge, called Big Red for its rusty color, is an old steel trestle bridge. It's a local landmark and stretches just under 1,000 feet as it crosses the river. As picturesque as it is, my favorite is actually the low-profile bridge near Freeze, Virginia. It's over 1,000 feet across the river. It's such a pleasant, gentle downhill ride that you almost want to turn around and go back and do it again, except that you're still 20 miles from the midpoint. Got to thinking about bridges recently when I read an article about bridges of faith. It's actually a collection of stories reflecting on the significance of the image of bridges in the life of faith. It was intriguing, and it was different. I couldn't remember ever preaching a sermon about bridges, and I wondered why that was. Then I discovered that there are no bridges in the Bible. At first, I was so surprised, I looked repeatedly. I looked at old translations, new translations. I looked at concordances and dictionaries. No bridges. Now, it's not because there were no So I had to rethink. Bridges fail. What does a bridge do? What does it look like in the life of faith? At the simplest level, bridges span a gap. They connect something, some things that were otherwise disconnected. They provide a way across where it might otherwise be impassable, like the bridges on the New River. They do for us what we cannot do on our own. Paul Northwood was hiking an unfamiliar trail in the mountains with a friend. Toward the end of the first day, they came upon a gently babbling brook. They could see a washed out bridge nearby, flipped upside down. It should have been a clue, but the water was low and they found a place where they could cross on stepping stones. They hiked for a few days, it began to rain. They were prepared for rain, they had rain here, so they continued to hike several days in the rain. And when they finally returned to the babbling brook, it was a raging river. The stepping stones were several feet underwater. There was an initial sense of panic. The river went on for quite a long way. The only bridge was still flipped upside down on the other side of the river. They were not prepared for this. They emptied their packs looking for anything that might help. There was one piece of rope used for hanging their food in a tree out of reach of bears. One was a strong swimmer. She tied an end of the rope to a tree on their side. She crossed the water. Luckily, the rope was just long enough to tie it to a tree on the other side. And using that rope, they together managed to carry their gear across and get safely to the other side of the river. Later, Paul wrote, she put her life in the hands of God that day, and her faith in the rope, and slowly made her way to the other side. For Paul, the rope spanned the gap. It connected the river's banks. It made a way to the other side, but it also pushed questions of faith. Did she trust the rope? Could she rely on her friend? Was she willing to put her life in the hands of God? All of which brings us much closer to what Paul is talking about in his letter to the Galatians. On one side of Paul's river, we have sin and condemnation. We are not able to fulfill the works required by the law of God unless we are condemned. We are condemned insofar as we are separated from God by the river of law. There is no bridge. We cannot cross over, even if God is the greatest desire of our heart. According to Paul, that is our situation without Christ. However, Christ has crossed over the river of law from God's side to our side. Christ has spanned the raging river connecting the two banks and made a way across. Christ, according to Scripture, is the way, truth, and life. Paul variously calls this many things. God has adopted us in Christ. God has redeemed us. God has set us free in Christ. We have a bridge, if you will, in Christ. The good news is that in Christ we are free to cross over to God's side. The writer Frederick Beamer says it simply. A bridge is built. Love is done. Not sentimental, emotional love, but love that is pontifex, bridge building. It's the power of God's love in the world that makes a way for us that connects. just to be clear, it's freedom for a purpose. It's not absolute freedom of choice or freedom for self-indulgence. Paul tells us we are set free to love and serve one another. Our freedom in Christ is freedom for connection, freedom to love others as God has loved us in Christ. It's freedom empowered by the Spirit to follow the example of Christ's sacrificial love. When Rebecca Boydton was a child in Uruguay, she enjoyed spending time in her father's tailor shop, listening to him tell stories from his childhood. He had grown up in Armenia until war broke out in 1915. He was forced to flee his home. He stayed on the move, walking by day, hiding by night. One day he was walking down the road, saw a group of boys heading his way. Feared for his safety, since he was Armenian and Christian, father scrambled into a ditch, raised his arms and prayed to God, "Dear God, save me." In a moment of desperation, he waved down the passing car. The driver stopped. He took a risk. He explained his situation. The driver told him to get into the car and asked him, "Where are you going?" "Anywhere," he said. "Anywhere." The man took him to an inn, got him some clean clothes. That night, he took a bath. He had a good meal. He had a good night's sleep. The next morning, he was eager to thank the man who had helped him. But it was nowhere to be found. It's gone. The stranger paid for the night in the inn, left some money with the clerk for the young man, and never saw the stranger again. This stranger lived out Christ's parable of the Good Samaritan, caring for her father, even though he was a stranger. We can see the fruits of the Spirit in his kindness, generosity, and love, shown by one stranger to another. And we recognize that we have the ability to do the same with others. Bill Harkins is a pastoral counselor in Atlanta, and he has been the pastor to many pastors through his years of ministry. Tells the story of a good friend and colleague who served as a priest for 40 years. He retired to Atlanta and worked as a spiritual formation director in the church that they both worked in Atlanta. Something he deeply loved, enabling others to bear the fruit of the Spirit in their lives. Retired priest, developed leukemia. Lots of treatment, lots of time in the hospital, lots of time to think about how he wanted things to happen. In one of his last conversations with Bill, he told Bill, "I've had so much love." Bill responded, "Yes, there are so many people who love you and are grateful for you." But that's not what his friend meant. He went a different direction. Fred explained, "What I mean is that there are so many people whom I have loved. I have so much gratitude to God for the love God gave me and enabled me to give away." His illness had caused him to reflect on such things as the quantity of life versus quality of life. He thought about the fruit of his life, said that his illness freedom to love that bridges the gaps between people. It's binding ourselves to each other that bears